Honorable guest, respected faculty and fellow students, a very warm good morning to you all. I take this opportunity on behalf of I'm the Change Initiative on Sustainability and Social Responsibility and Academic Committee, IMT Ghaziabad, and welcome you all to the 10th I'm the Change talk. Today we have a special guest with us. We have with us Dr. Bharat Vatwani. He is the founder and trustee of Shraddha Rehabilitation Center, an organization which is responsible for rescuing, treating, rehabilitating, and reuniting destitute who are mentally challenged and on the streets of India with their families. His relentless efforts over the years were then recognized in 2018 by the Ramon Magsaysay Award. He has now joined a list of illustrious winners, which include Acharya Vinoba Bhave, Chief Minister of Delhi Arvind Kejriwal, Ms. Kiran Bedi, Pandit Ravi Shankar, and many more. Please give him a rousing round of applause. We have gathered together here on a very auspicious occasion. And for any auspicious occasion to start, we need to light the lamp. A light has a significance. It is the manifestation of the Almighty in the form of light, as it turns away ignorance and gives way to wisdom. I now request Professor Das, DJ Madman, Mr. Singh, and Dr. Vatwani to please light the lamp.
May I request my faculty colleagues also to join us on stage? We will also have a group photograph with sir. Please join us on stage, all of you present. Faculty colleagues, staff colleagues who are present, please join us on stage.
I now request Professor Das and Mr. Singh to provide Dr. Vatwani with our welcome bouquet and the token of appreciation from IMT. Due to prior commitments, Professor Talwar could not be here today with us. However, he was kind enough to record a message to address everyone gathered here today.
Long before mental health got enshrined in the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, SDG3, a psychiatrist from India took it upon himself as a lone crusader against the problem of mental health, especially a lot of people that we actually encounter and we see on a daily basis. You know, people who require this kind of help and they were living on the streets of India. What started off as an informal operation for bringing mentally ill people who were living on the streets, street dwellers, to his private clinic for treatment, finally culminated into the creation of something called Shraddha Rehabilitation Foundation for the Wandering Mentally Ill Destitute on the streets. This was founded long ago in 1988, an initiative that aimed at helping people who required this kind of help, who were living on the streets, providing free shelter, free food and psychiatric treatment, and reuniting them with their families. Meet Dr. Bharat, founder, trustee, and chief functionary of Shraddha Rehabilitation Foundation, and a recipient of the esteemed Ramon Magsaysay Award, widely revered as Asia's Nobel Prize. In electing Dr. Vatwani to receive, when he was receiving the Raymond Magsaysay Award in 2018, the Board of Trustees recognized his tremendous courage and read and healing compassion in embracing India's mentally afflicted destitute and his steadfast and magnanimous dedication to the work of restoring and affirming the human dignity of even the most ostracized in our midst. We at Ghaziabad are deeply humbled and honored to have the privilege of hosting Dr. Vatwani at a very own Ghaziabad campus. This is a part, the reason why Dr. Vatwani is here today with us is to, one, deliver 10th edition of our distinguished I Am the Change talk series. Apart from that, this also begins our 6th edition of the globally acclaimed Sustainability and Social Responsibility Initiative course that's been inspired by the Mahatma's teachings. This course, and I'm sure you will hear a lot more from other faculty, Professor Kasturi Das especially, has been instrumental in being able to create a vision amongst management institutions, business schools, who believe that business and business education exists not only to be able to provide certain employability outcomes, but to also be able to ensure that people learn over a period of time the fact that there's much more responsibility for them, engaging in projects which are meaningful, engaging in projects that are able to change and shape people's lives. Today, I would also like to take the opportunity to thank all the faculty who are engaged in this mission, who are engaged in the SSR project, and I Am the Change Initiative, Professor Kasturi Das, and of course, a lot of other people, the backroom operators, the administrative staff, who are all part of this initiative to be able to successfully conduct the SSR course over the many years that we have engaged and done this course. We've had so many different organizations, NGOs, a lot of micro enterprises who benefited from a lot of initiatives that we've taken as part of the SSR. Of course, once again, I would like to reiterate the fact that we are humbled, we are thankful, and we're actually grateful to Dr. Bharat Vatwani to come along today and deliver the 10th I Am the Change talk. Thank you very much.
I now cede the stage and the dais to Dr. Vatwani, and I request him to enlighten us with his wisdom and his experiences.
Thank you, everybody, for coming over to listen to this lecture. I'm not sure whether I'll be able to do justice or not, but let's give it a try. First thing first, I woke up at 2:30 in the morning yesterday, caught the flight. I'm here. So I might be a little bit woozy, might be a little bit drowsy, but take it in your stride. Coming to basics, as far as all the students go, literally all of us start our careers in the same manner in which you have done. The same time pass, the same moj masti, the same everything. I was no different. The only thing was that when I entered medicine, I found medicine very difficult. I was brilliant in maths. In those days, vocational guidance was not there. So, and both my brothers were already in the same line. They were all already students in medicine. So I ended up taking medicine. I found medicine very difficult, very, very, very difficult. I mean, I cannot tell you how difficult the whole thing was. By the time I finished my MBBS, I had enough of mugging, what is known as plain and simple mugging. So I decided to go for general practice, what is known as a family doctor. I tried my hand at family doctor for a couple of years, didn't succeed. And I picked up a non-medical job. In those days, we were financially very bad. I had lost my dad when I was in the 8th standard. Things were very difficult. And I picked up a non-medical job. When one of my seniors came and told me that, by the way, there's a post in psychiatry which is vacant. So I said, look, boss, I need the money very badly of this non-medical job. I can't dare attend that classes, because in those days they used to pay some 300 or 400 rupees to the person working in the wards. He managed the attendance part. I took 15 days off from my non-medical job, studied a little bit, just barely passed. What is known as Diploma in Psychiatry Part 1. Again, I continued with the non-medical job, just took off for 15 days, just barely studied one or two chapters here and there. Again, by the grace of God, I passed. I was a qualified psychiatrist, having seen exactly 5 patients in my whole life of psychiatry, and there I was. Now comes the next part. There was an MD post which was vacant in another hospital. So I said, now I have to give the non-medical job. So I gave the non-medical job and I joined MD. There I met a very beautiful girl who was my lecturer. I was the youngest guy in the whole department and she was the lecturer. She was an MD, gold medalist, psychiatrist, and she was very beautiful. So I and she somehow ended up falling in love. When we ended up falling in love, as it is, I was very bad at studies. I didn't enjoy it also. So mentally, I thought to myself that, look, the girl whom I marry is a gold medalist. She knows her subject inside out. There's no need to study. So I ended up, I was never a good academic person in the first place. I became worse. And in the process, I ended up failing my MD psychiatry first shot. So there I was, an MD failure, and there she was, the MD gold medalist. So her father, who was the director of medical education and research in those days, big shot guy, he called me and he said, Bharat, enough is enough. Agar tu agli bar pass nahi hua, tu gaya. You will lose my daughter. So I got mortally scared. Me bola, sara ladki haath se jayegi. Ek to knowledge bhi nahi hai, ladki bhi gayi. So I started studying. And by the grace of God, by the help of everything, I just barely cleared. 1st April 1987, I cleared. 30th April 1987, I was married. But as they say, you know, that destiny has its own chakkar to play. Which is why I said, just now I was hearing somebody admonishing for not having this and not studying or whatever. Forget all that, yeah. My point is very simple. Unless you have failed a couple of times, you can't get the Ramon Magsaysay Award. I have already set a benchmark. So, luck being what it is, I and my wife were having nashta in a restaurant, South Indian restaurant, typical, idli vada, whatever. And across the street was a guy with long hair, talking to himself, muttering to himself, making gestures. And we could make out as psychiatrists that he's mentally ill. Now, honestly, the desire to do anything did not come. But coincidentally, what happened was that he took an empty coconut shell, dipped it into the gutter water flowing behind, and he picked up the empty coconut shell and drank the whole water at a single shot. Oh boy. Not knowing whether what was legal, what was illegal, both of us got so moved that we just reached out to him, crossed the road, and asked him, will you come with us? He agreed. Had he not agreed, I would not be standing in front of you, but he agreed. Luck being what it is, we had just started a small nursing home. I had sold off all my wife's jewelry. We had 5.5 lakhs loan on our heads. Not even a single item was there. This guy was the first patient. Anyway, he improved. When he improved, we found out that he was a BSc pass graduate, had come to Bombay for a job and had not got a job and had become mentally ill and was on the roads. So in those days, there was no mobile, nothing. We sent a letter to his house after he had recovered. That father came down from Kadapa in Andhra Pradesh by flight from Hyderabad. And he turned out to be a Zilla Parishad superintendent. Also English speaking, also educated. Then I and my wife thought to ourselves that, look, an educated person is on the road from an educated family. And there's nobody doing anything for him. That's how the ball started. At the end of the day, this talk is all about the emotions and the passion behind I am the change. The most important thing on that particular day when we picked up was the emotion. If you look at it from a very practical point of view, we were not well off. We had a massive loan on our heads. We had not yet established in practice. But at that moment, thinking that you had all this and you are staying in a rental place, whatever, Logic says, step behind, don't enter the picture. The passion says, the emotion says, reach out. And we have reached out then, and we have been reaching out since then. That's the simple funda of the whole reason why I'm here. So we continue doing all this. I'll give you a background of what we are doing. These are all mentally ill people who are on the roads. Now, often you see them everywhere. You'll see them close to railway stations. You'll see them because they are often come by train. Nobody bothers to ask for a ticket. So you have these guys who are in bad shape. You know, nobody bothers. They are the shunned, neglected. You walk across them, you don't give them a second thought. That is a tragedy. A young female is on the road with a helmet on her head, which somebody must have put to make fun of her. And nobody's doing anything. The same female with her family in Palghar. Same female. You look at the difference. Now you see this guy, nobody would have touched him with a 10-foot pole. But our social worker did it. Same person in the ambulance, same person at his house in Karnataka. The guy comes from a good family, but nobody is bothered. The sad part of the whole thing is that humanity is shunned. They're sitting there for days, months, years, nobody looks at them. This is our social workers reaching out. This is a female who was in Chhattisgarh. See the condition in which she was picked up and the condition in which she was reunited. That is the emotion which takes you forward. Just that, you know, one sister showing another sister, what are you wearing? What am I wearing? These are the moments that really touch you, and these are the moments that take you forward. So I remembered this video, and my staff remembered it, and they were so happy that they could do that. That in a tribal village, they could take the sister back, and the two sisters exchange lovey-dovey exchanges. It's a simple thought. It's not much. It's just happiness personified. There is a poem by Thomas Eliot which says, where is the knowledge we have lost in information? Where is the wisdom we have lost in knowledge? And where is the life we have lost in the living? All of you people come here from different corners of the country attempting to do your post-graduation in business management, this, that, finance, marketing. At the end of the day, each one of you has to ask himself, where is the life we have lost in living? Where is the knowledge we have lost in the information? And where is the wisdom we have lost in the knowledge? These are the important issues which matter. This is, like I said, the earlier days. This is 1990 when the first article had come about us. This is my father-in-law standing over there. This is a small five-bedded nursing home in which we started off the place. This is a letter from somebody in Srinagar who was reunited. The patient was picked up in Bombay. His relatives were traced out. We sent a letter to Srinagar and the mother came running down by flight again. Good family, this guy whom we picked up finished his MBA from Bangalore and is now working. Had our institution not entered the picture, he perhaps would have been on the road for donkey's years. Such is life. This is again multiple newspaper coverage. This is a gold medalist lecturer from JJ School of Arts. A gold medalist lecturer from JJ School of Arts on the roads. That is the tragedy of the whole thing. We picked him up, we brought him, we treated him. When we treated him, his colleagues and his fellow people who were there, they said, why not have a fundraising art exhibition? So we had a fundraising art exhibition in 1993, covered up by multiple newspapers. Massive, huge number of artists gave their paintings. Anjali Lamanan, Bikash Bhattacharji, S.H. Raza, Namcheen people. Huge success it was. And this was our small project that we, this is the exhibition which was inaugurated by Sunil Dutt in the good old days. You see this guy on the left, the male fellow. He's a VJTI engineer, VJTI civil engineer on the roads. This is us in the good old days. That's me, my wife, and my first kid in my arms. We had gone to Jalgaon to reunite a patient in our own car. This is the first patient which I told you about, the guy down with his father. He's the BSc pass fellow. So we finally, from that art exhibition, we got a money to start this small institution in Daisar, which is just on the outskirts of Bombay. It is a part of Bombay, actually. Jayantiben Mehta, who was the BJP MP at that time, came to inaugurate the place. But there was a huge uproar in the societies around that we don't want a mental hospital in our locality. We do not want mentally ill patients in our locality because we feel that our females will be threatened, our children will be threatened, etc., etc., etc. There was a huge uproar, a signature campaign. If you ask me which was the toughest time of our entire span of this NGO, it was this particular period. We had a morcha taken out by all the citizens. Gali gali mein shor hai, Dr. Vatwani chor hai, Shraddha Murdabad. To the extent that finally once when my wife was there, she was pushed to the ground. So we went and approached that same Jayanti Ben Mehta who had inaugurated. She called the commissioner of police in Mumbai. That commissioner called the deputy commissioner of police in Daisar. That guy appointed a Havaldar at our site 24/7. So we were doing social work under police protection. So the society for which you're doing itself does not want you. And you're doing work under police protection. Those were trying times. I mean, really, really, really difficult. When you start questioning yourself as to why are we doing what we are doing and is it worth it? This was a massive letter of support which we got from TISS. Finally, the matter went to court. 1.5 years, the matter was in court. Anand Grover, who's the advocate right now in Supreme Court, fighting for a lot of human rights, and he won the LGBT case recently. He was our advocate. And the person in opposition was Dhananjay Chandrachud, the current Chief Justice of India, or I think he just resigned. Just turned this thing. Now the golden question is this, that when the entire society is against you, when hundreds, thousands have put up a signature campaign, when the patient is not asking you that they want your help, the patient is mentally ill on the road, then why are you doing what you're doing? Why are you doing what you're doing? These are the introspective questions which I believe were the litmus test of our entire NGO career. I felt, my wife felt, and my other trustee felt that, look, boss, if we give up today, then in your entire lifetime, you will never be able to look a mentally ill person on the road and tell him that I could help you out. You will never be able to do it. Your entire life will go with guilt, thinking that you didn't help out a person who ideally you were the most professionally taught person to handle that person. I mean, barring a psychiatrist, who else will understand a person on the road? But every day, believe me, every day, we were literally in tears, thinking that let's give up. This whole court case lasted for 1.5 years. Some politicians were involved and they troubled us. Don't ask. The gamut of pressure. And we were young. We were 38, 40, whatever. So handling that thing taught us that finally, if you want to achieve change, you have to stay put. You have to be like that tree, which is dug deep, with your roots deep. Nothing, no wind, no storm, nothing can shake you. This is a principal from the on the road. She's a principal from a school in Calcutta. Again, multiple newspapers have covered us up. Despite all that, there is hardly any lack of actual awareness in society as to what are the cause of mental illness. What happens? Why are people on the roads? Now, this is the second phase. This is the phase in 2004. When my social worker told me, let's go and meet Baba Amte. So I said, okay, let's go and meet Baba Amte. We went by car. Now, I don't know how many of you have seen Anandvan, which is in Vardha and Varora in Maharashtra. But Baba Amte was a famous well-known, renowned social worker of those days. So we went. 2,500 leprosy patients. Huge setup, huge, unbelievable. I was profusely in tears when I saw the setup. But Baba Amte was not there. So I was in the car. So I said, let's go further ahead. Let's meet him. He was in Hemalkasa, another distant place on the border of Maharashtra and Andhra Pradesh in Gadchiroli district. So we went by car. When we went by car, around 100 kilometers before Hemalkasa, we came across a guy who was in chains. Both hands, both legs in chains. A mentally ill person who had been chained and left on the streets. Unbelievable sight. Unbelievable. Not a man ahead, not a man behind. Just that man. Now the first instinct is don't touch him. So I told my social worker, ask him, that will he come to with us? That fellow said, no, I'll not come. So I thought, matter is over. 20 kilometers further down the line, darkness was setting in, and my conscience woke up, and I asked myself as to what will happen to this guy who is both hands, both legs in chains with not a soul in sight in the dense jungles of Gadchiroli. What will happen? Where will he sleep? What will he eat? So I did a U-turn. Being a psychiatrist, I was able to put on him, and he agreed. Now, he had been passing urine and motions in his clothes since God knows when. He was stinking badly. I had a scissor with me. I cut off all his clothes, had a chadar, put it around him, put him in the center of the car, put all the windows down, and started off. Now, again, those were not the days of the mobile. Prakash Amte didn't know I was coming. Baba Amte didn't know we were coming. So with great hesitation, you know, at 8:30 in the night, we reached his place. So I was literally trembling, you know. So I told him, sir, don't bura mat manna, hum log ye kaam kar rahe hain. Will you remove the chains of this guy? That was the turning point. Prakash Amte called for a chinni and a hathoda. And he started doing that work on his own. It was a delicate work. It took him 1.5 hours. And Baba Amte was just sitting there. I didn't have the guts to utter a word. The chains were removed. The patient went off. I'll show you the photo. This is the patient. This is Prakash Amte. And these are the chains. So it was such delicate work. See the emaciated condition of the patient. Finally, he called for a hacksaw to cut open the chain. And finally, all the chains were removed. The chains are on the ground. And in this whole process, Baba Amte was just lying there, watching. He didn't utter a word. Next day morning, I got up at 4:30. I went down. And I found that Baba Amte was awake and he was in tears. He was crying. So I asked him, what happened? He said, whole night I did not get sleep. Whole night I did not get sleep thinking as to how could society do this, that put a man in chains and leave him on the road. And he actually took the chains, put it on his hands and legs and attempted to walk. Oh boy. I had lost my dad very young. So you subconsciously tend to hunt for a father figure. And I felt that here is a man who is treating 2,500 leprosy patients, who has got a room full of awards. He was a Padma Shri, Padma Bhushan. Don't ask how many foreign awards he had got. I mean, he was just, that whole room was full of awards. Despite that, ego had not gone to his head and he was still as compassionate, as empathetic, as sensitive as what he was on day one. That was miraculous. That was miraculous. That was that emotion and that was that passion which touched my heart. I believe that on that particular day, it happened to be my birthday, on June 19th, 2004, when I met that guy between 4 and 4:30, I was a changed man. I was a changed man. I felt, here is God, that a man can still start crying, weeping at the dukkh of somebody else who's unrelated to him. It's not that that man is related to him. It's not that that man falls within his sphere of activities. No. Despite that, he got touched. So we were there for 72 hours and jate jate, he told me just one thing. Bharat, kaam achha hai, lekin bahut chote paimane pe kar raha. Think big. So I said, okay, let's think big. So I came back. Then I took my wife. I took my other trustee. We went again. I took this patient in an improved condition, showed him to Baba Amte. He was thrilled. That's how the ball started moving. So the question is this. After that, every 15 days, he would ring me up. The Baba Amte would ring me up and say, Bharat, how far has the project reached? I mean, you know, to buy a plot and all that is not an easy thing, yaar. So I was getting frustrated. This man is going on ringing up. One day I told my wife, hey, budde ko kuch kaam dena nahi, mere hi piche pad gaya hai. But he persisted. He persisted. And that he saw that spark in me. He saw that something in me which I myself had never seen. And he persisted. And that persistence finally resulted in us getting the plot. These are my photographs of the good old days when I was with Baba Amte, 2004. There is a quote from his biography which says that I have always been drawn to this fellowship of pain. I think God created pain because without it, there would be no tenderness. It is very easy for a man to love God. It is very easy for a man to love God. It is very difficult for him to follow the commandment, love thy neighbor. The herd doesn't wait for the wounded deer. The herd doesn't wait for the wounded deer. Therefore, someone else must help. And he felt that I was that someone else who could help that wandering mentally ill on the roads. He felt that. We were doing work, but it was very small compared to what image he had of me and what vision he had for me. So this is the plot that we purchased in 2004. This is the two units which were inaugurated by Prakash Amte. It's a 6.5 acre plot of land. Since they are usually villagers, they are able to do all this rice cultivation and whatever. It's open to sky. The center part of every unit is open to the sky. I'm just going through quickly so you have an idea of what exactly we are doing. And this is Prakash Amte in the good old days inaugurating the place. Gudi Padwa, very auspicious occasion, Maharashtra, March 2006. Baba Amte had written a very nice letter for us. And I believe that letter coming from a guru far supersedes any other award that I may have ever got in my life. Brilliant, inspirational words. I believe, which I'm hoping that should be imbibed by each and every one of you, that what set Baba Amte apart was his compassion for the downtrodden. His understanding of the pain of human existence, the overpowering desire to reach out and try to ameliorate it, to try to reduce it, to try to buffer it, was the guiding star of his life. So it did not matter in which category that patient was. The truth of the matter was that that person was in pain. And Baba Amte felt that if he could do something to reduce it, let's do it. It's a simple concept. It's a concept which ideally should strike you and strike me and strike everybody around. But it doesn't. It doesn't. That is the tragedy. Yesterday, I had a guy in my consulting. He was a psychiatrist himself. He had just passed out. And he came to me because he was depressed. Why was he depressed? He was depressed because he had not yet started his practice. He had not yet done this. He had not yet earned that much money, etc., etc., etc. All the time, we humans are taught to think of ourselves as have-nots. So we don't have this, so I'm dukhi. We don't have this, so I'm dukhi. What about the dukh of the person across the road? What about the dukh of the person who's in 100 times worse shape than you? Unfortunately, we are not ingrained. We are not wired to think of that other person. That is the tragedy. And that, I believe, to a great extent, Gandhi need not have done whatever he did. He could have continued with his own life. He was a barrister. He could have done very well for himself. But the fact that when he was pushed off that train in South Africa, he thought, he introspected and realized that something could be done and something needed to be done. It is that level of introspection which you reach as students, as adults, as people who are coming up in society, Today, each and every one of you students might think, "Arre, abhi ye post graduation hone ke baad kaun sa job milega? Which company will hire me? What is the online situation? What is the on-campus recruitment?" You're all the time thinking of the future. The truth is that being students of such a meritorious institution in itself makes all of you haves. You're not in the have-nots. All of you are in the haves. The very fact that I am a JJ Hospital, Grand Medical College alumni, that it is itself makes me a have. I may have been the last guy who have cleared. I may have plucked my exam. No big deal. But the truth is that the moment I entered that college, I was a have. I was not a have not. Unless you get that concept right, that thing continues. I remember I went to Miraj Medical College to give a talk. So after the talk, we had lunch together and one of the HOD told me, "Sir, I'm so impressed by your talk, so impressed by your talk. I have decided one thing. Once I retire, I will only do charitable work." Now that gentleman was 42 years old. I was just thinking, when will he retire and when will he actually enter charitable work? So that thing is there. Let's postpone. For the timing, we don't have this. We don't have that. We don't have this. Our children doesn't have that. Right now, I'm thinking of my daughter's marriage. Right now, I'm thinking of my mother's this thing. Something else, something else, something else. It's like that Satyanarayan Katha. You know, you go round and round, and you don't do the Katha only. I felt that that guy will never ever in his lifetime do any charitable work. If you want to reach that stage, well, then you're already in it. You guys are already in it. But if you want to move out, if you want to broaden your vision, if you want to do something else, this is it. Then you have to think in a different manner, the way Baba Amte thought. This is our symbol, logo. On the left is the Ganpati of Hindu religion. After that is the Allah of the Muslim religion. After that, in the center, the cross of Christianity. After that is the Ek Onkar of Punjabi Gurmukhi. And after that is the Parsi symbol of fire. All humanity is one. All faith is one. All suffering is one. The illness does not define who will fall sick. The illness touches everybody. The man on the street could be a Hindu, could be a Muslim, could be a Christian, could be anything. Could be from UP, could be from Bihar, could be from West Bengal, anywhere. But he's there. All suffering is one. All humanity is one. This is just to give an example of how easy it is comparatively to pick up a person, which people find very scary, but this guy is a chartered accountant, by the way. This is us in the good old days. This is my wife who has taken the patient in Andhra Pradesh. So we used to reunite in the good old days ourselves. We didn't have social workers. This is the before and after photos. I mean, even if the relative is hunting for his own saga sambandhi, that person on the roads has changed dramatically. This is a rare emotional reunion wherein a child is crying after being reunited with his father. So it's not just one single guy who's left the family. It's the whole family getting affected. It's the whole neighborhood getting affected. It's the whole community getting affected. This is us taking all these patients belong to Andhra Pradesh. All of them are being taken at a single shot. Massive awareness happens when you reunite the person. In this, where's the pointer over here? Yeah, okay. In this, you'll see a guy. I mean, it's such an emotional thing, you'll miss it. But it's there. You see a guy who will come from this side. He's the grandfather of this patient. I mean, it is such a touching thing that it changes your whole conceptualization of life. That is the emotion which takes you forward. Doing good not because you want to be appreciated. Doing good because the goodness itself is an end result in itself. That is the whole idea. Unfortunately, a lot of the youngsters have this habit of attempting to do good and posting it on social media and waiting for the likes and this and that and all that. Forget it. This reunion will remain with our staff for a lifetime. This is again another very rare video. The mother, because of mental illness, left the house. The kid was taunted by all his friends and all the people that teri mother pagal thi, wo bhag gayi. Very, very disturbing. So the extent to which one mental illness can affect the entire family, the entire neighborhood, the entire communities, it's a rare thing. I mean, you can imagine the plight of the boy had we not reunited that mother. This is in Bihar. The mother doing what is absolute innate to her, motherhood. She pacifies the child and takes the thing. Again, this was never covered on any social media. This was never recorded in any newspaper. This is just between us and the gods above. This is again another school-going female admonishing her mother, scolding her mother for having run away. This is in Andhra Pradesh. This was recently, just a few months ago. Such is life. While all along you see them everywhere, you see it at every station, every railroad, every place. Such is life. And the daughter is in depression over there, thinking that the mother has left her and she's being taunted by all her classmates, by everybody around. Had we not reunited the mother, God alone knows what would happen to the child's marriage. This is a beautiful thing which one of the college people had, they had done a ramp show and given us 55,555. They had collected between themselves and them. This is us picking up the mentally ill from the in an ambulance. This lady whom you see, this lady, she is the mother of this orthopedic surgeon. So the mother of an orthopedic surgeon on the roads in Surat. There are huge, 5,000 people must have gathered for that reunion. This is a guy who's from Iran, picked up from the roads. This guy. Very difficult. We had one guy who could, one social worker who could speak a little Arabic. So when we started asking him the names of all the countries where Arabic is spoken, when suddenly we mentioned Iran, his eyes flashed up. And he wrote in his handwriting his name, his phone number. He wrote in his handwriting the sister's name, the wife's name, daughter's name. Slow process. Took us 2-3 months to get this information out of him. Finally, I approached the consulate general of the Iran, got an official temporary passport made, and he was deported officially. Kerala news, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar. This is the mother of a politician, a mother of a politician who was reunited in Andhra Pradesh. This is one of those kids who run away from the house on some excuse or the other, on some fight with the parents, and 54 years later he is reunited in Jalandhar. Madhya Pradesh. Now the golden question is, what is the philosophy behind this whole thing? Why are we doing what we are doing? One of the greatest literature which I've ever read is Baba Sahib Ambedkar's The Buddha and His Dhamma. It says that men are born unequal. Some are robust, others are weaklings. This I quote unquote his book. Some have more capacity, more intelligence, others have less. Some are well-to-do, others are poor. All have to enter into what is called the struggle of existence. And if in this struggle of existence, inequality is recognized as the rule of the game. Inequality is recognized as the rule of the game. The weakest will always go to the wall. The weakest will always go to the wall. Should this rule of inequality be allowed to be the rule of life? Question which makes you think. So we are here, all the ITM graduates from all over India, the haves. And there are others in remote Mufassil areas of India, unable to access the knowledge, the wisdom, did not have that intelligence to grasp all this. Should they be pushed against the wall if this rule of inequality is to be followed? That is the golden question. Some answer in the affirmative, claiming that it results in the survival of the fittest. The question, however, is the fittest the best from the point of view of society? Is the fittest the best from the point of view of society? No one can give a positive answer. So religion, all religions, preach equality. Now, all of us believe a lot in religion. We have multiple temples, multiple churches, multiple gurdwaras, monasteries, mosques, everything. We do our fasting, upas. We have the roza before Eid. We have the Navratri before Dasera, Ram Navami. We have the Lent before Easter. And we have the Parushan amongst Jains. But how many of us actually strive for this equality, actually pray for the hopes and aspirations of the underprivileged in India? How many of us do it? The truth is that in majority of the cases, in majority of the times, we are only praying for ourselves. That is the truth. And that truth, unless it is changed, things will remain status quo. So finally, it amounts to nullifying that religiosity in itself, which we claim we are so proud of, which we claim we are devout Hindus, we are devout Muslims, we are devout Catholics. When the truth is that we don't practice that equality, we don't do it at all. The question is that if we as civilized society continue with this rule of inequality, where is justice? Where is brotherhood? Where is compassion? Where is mercy? Where is empathy? Where is love? And above all, where is that God that we claim we all of us have within us? Where is that God? So to remove that rule of inequality, we have to continue to fight social injustice. Therein lies the emotional hub of an empowering thought and the genesis of true social work. This is what moved Gandhi forward. This is what moved Gandhi forward. In an attempt to reduce that inequality which exists in society. So dharma is not just dharma for oneself. Dharma is dharma for everybody. And that's how he started moving. If you look at the whole story of his, if you look at his whole autobiography, he started off as ordinary as you and me. But somewhere along the line, things changed. Somewhere along the line, dimensions changed. Somewhere along the line, attitudes changed. Somewhere along the time, wisdom came through. And things became very, he reached where he is. And what is the hard reality of India? What is the hard reality of India? The truth is that 363 million Indians, 36.3 crores, 27% of the population live below the poverty line. What is the poverty line? The poverty line is 32 rupees a day in rural India. The number of disabled in India is 27 million. The number of mentally ill people in India are 197 million. 19.7 crores are mentally ill. 110 million are tribals. And as per Dr. Arun Gadre, who's my classmate, he says that 6.2 crores are added every year to the BPL in India because of healthcare expenses. This is the harsh reality of India. We, living in our cocoons, are not aware of what is the harsh reality of India. We stay blinded because we choose to stay blinded. We choose to be not the change which society would want us to be. We choose to be not that change which Gandhi had thought that everybody would have. We choose. Now the question is, can we re-choose? Can we realign? Can we think differently? This is a small film which is there of us.
Providing shelter to the mentally ill and the roadside destitute is Shraddha, a rehabilitation home in Karjat in Maharashtra.
Initially, we are looking after basic hygiene and basic nutrition. Person is in a bad shape physically. Then we gradually start psychiatric medicine on him in a very slow format. So because we have a good vast campus, hum log unko rice cultivation, vegetable cultivation, dairy farming, isme hum lagate hain. This kind of, you know, brings them back to their roots. I feel more than teaching them a skill, the improvement rate is much faster.
As patients get better and start recalling their past, it is time for Dr. Vatwani and his team of social workers to take them back to their homes.
We don't establish contact with the family. We directly take them to that particular village where we believe they belong from, because that creates an impact on the whole village. That is the idea. Finally, they realize that here is a person who has become all right and is being brought back. So mental illness is a treatable commodity. That word tends to spread very fast.
जब हमने संदीप को देखा कि थाना रोड पे बैठा है, वो संदीप था, उसको पिकअप किया हम लोग वहाँ पे. उसकी उस टाइम कंडीशन ऐसी थी, वो एक टूटा सा चश्मा लगा कर था, एक तरफ ग्लास की एक तरफ ग्लास नहीं थी, और शर्ट पहन के था, और एक कांग्रेस का एक झंडा लगा के वो गले पे लगाया था. मतलब कि उसका एक स्टाइल था कि वो यहाँ का हीरो है, और मुंबई जगह पहचान के वो अपने हीरो के स्टाइल में चल रहा था.
क्या नाम है
आपका? रियूनियन करने ले गए उसको, वो बांकुड़ा जिले का था. गांव पहुंचने के बाद गांव वाले बहुत खुश हुए. 7-10 साल के बाद वो घर पहुंचा.
घूम दे
माँ ने जब उसे देखा तो माँ जैसे ही उसे देखी, उसे मिलने से पहले ही वो जाके नदी में छलांग मारी, अपने आप को पवित्र किया, वहां से निकल के आई, फिर अपने बेटे को छुआ, अपने बेटे से बातचीत की. वो हमारे लिए बहुत अच्छा था, और घर वाले पूरे गांव वाले जमा हो गए. उसके चाचा भी थे, वो भी पुलिस में थे, उन्होंने भी बहुत तलाश किया, खोज नहीं पाई, लेकिन जब हम लोग लेके गए, हमारा बहुत सम्मान हुआ, हमारी इज्जत भी की, उन लोग बहुत खुश हुए. उन लोग
ये तो जंगीरे मिस्त्री का करकड़ा है. चलो भी चलो, तो बम्बे तो आए नहीं छड़न.
मैं इंजन के बाद कर दिया अंदर लगा था. मैंने दवाइयां नहीं
करना. सिर्फ हो गया
सारी कुछ
नहीं हो गया ना. सारा पिंड खुश है. सारा पिंड खुश है.
Another success story is that of Gangadhar Vinod, one of Dr. Vatwani's earliest patients.
He had met with an accident on the road. His leg was fractured. He couldn't walk. And he was literally in a catastrophic state.
मैं जिंदगी बदल गया. मैं तो मरने वाला था. मैं तो यही रोड के ऊपर पड़ा था. 18 साल था मेरा वो टाइम. इनका बहुत बड़ा काम है. ऐसा कोई घर वाला भी नहीं करता है. अगर कोई थोड़ा सा गलती करता है तो घर वाले भी मारते हैं, लेकिन ये लोग बहुत प्यार से.
There is a very famous song, 1958, Mukesh Sair Ludhianvi from a Raj Kapoor film. The elderly people must have heard about this. माना कि अभी तेरे मेरे अरमानों की कीमत कुछ भी नहीं, मिट्टी का भी है कुछ मोल मगर इंसानों की कीमत कुछ भी नहीं, इन भूखी प्यासी रूहों पर एक दिन तो कर्म फरमाएगी, वो सुबह कभी तो आएगी, वो सुबह कभी तो आएगी. दैट वॉज 1958, दिस इज 2022, 74 years down the line. इन भूखी प्यासी रूहों पर एक दिन तो कर्म फरमाएगी, वो सुबह कभी तो आएगी. वी स्टिल वेट फॉर दैट डॉन. The government, as usual, doesn't do much for mental illness. Mental illness is very shunned, and it spends only 0.8% of the total health budget on mental health. Now, what is the reality? The reality is that there are 18 lakh people. 18 lakh people who are on the roads, homeless. Out of this, 50 to 60% of them have got mental illness. So what is the total amount of mental illness on the road? There are 10 lakh people who are on the road because of mental illness. And what has Shraddha done? What has Shraddha done? All that it did was pick up, treated, rehabilitated, and reunited 9,500, max 10,000. That's all. Now the golden question is this, that what happens to the remaining 9,90,000 on the road? Who's going to do that? I mean, when I got the Raymond Magsaysay, I was stunned. I felt like going and hiding below the sofa. I felt, my God, we have done nothing. What are these guys up to? Look at the huge number of people who are there on the roads. Look at the huge amount of dukkha, which is there on the other side of the road in remote villages and remote areas, mufassil areas of India. There is a this of Rabindranath Tagore, which says that the one who plants trees, knowing that he will never sit in their shade, has at least started to understand the meaning of life. We at Shraddha console ourselves knowing that all the wandering mentally ill in India will never be catered to by us. Knowing that, but at least we started to understand the meaning of life. We hope that we have started to understand the meaning of life. Another Tagore gem for all the people who feel that life is useless. If you cry because the sun has gone out of your life, your tears will prevent you from seeing the stars. Brilliant. Compassion. Bhavna. Jise bolte na, dard, dusre ka dard samajhna. Empathy. Sensitivity. Compassion has no beginning, no ending. It is an ever-widening river reaching out to the sea. It matters not whether you are remembered or not. It matters not. It matters not whether your name is written in the annals of history or your ashes are immersed in the Ganga. It matters not. There is a statement by Mother Teresa which says that we ourselves feel that what we are doing is just a drop in the ocean, but the ocean would be less because of that missing drop. So what matters is whether because of your efforts, the quantum of pain and human suffering, in the sea of human suffering, sweeping across the length and breadth of our country, went down by that single solitary drop. That's all that matters. You see this female. This female was picked up by the wife of the chief minister of Himachal Pradesh, Jairam Thakur's wife. She was in Mandi, her hometown. She saw this female. From there, she brought her to Shimla Mental Hospital. From Shimla Mental Hospital, our staff brought her to Karjat. From Karjat, she improved. And finally, she was reunited in a remote village in Nagpur. And she turned out to be a tribal Catholic. And on the wall of her, this is written, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. And this reunion happened on the 25th of December. So on Christmas Day, you have a patient who's Catholic and is reunited with her family. And on that wall, you see, Jesus loves you. That is what is known as synchronization. And that, had it not appeared in this newspaper, it wouldn't have made a difference. I'm not a Catholic, but I believe that Jesus loves you. So Jesus loves us. That's all that matters. The gods are smiling upon you. It's a pointer to the fact that what you're doing is good and what you're doing needs to be done. This is me receiving the Raymond Magsaysay Award. You see this guy. This guy is the guy who was there in the video, Gangadhar. This is his father. This is his grandfather who came down with a traditional shawl and the traditional thali and they did the aarti. This boy has donated an ambulance to us. Right now, he's doing very well. He has a Toyota Fortuner. He's in the building industry. When I last rang him up, he was on a holiday in Vietnam. Had we not interfered, perhaps life would have been exactly where it was on the road. This is Time magazine which covered us. This is us in the USA when we were covered, me and my wife. This is the Gujarati Chitralekha. So when we were covered by this Gujarati Chitralekha, the journalist knew me since many years. So he said that when he was young, when he was in the 8th standard, 9th standard, there was a female on the road across his where he was staying in Gujarat. And they all used to get scared, like how people get scared of mentally ill. And he said from that day till today, she's still there at that same spot, still there on that same road. When he was in the 8th or 9th standard, he must have been 14 years old. Right now he's 45. So for 30 years, that lady is there. Rongte khade ho jate hain jab, when you think that what is a female doing on the road? Where must she be going to pass urine, motions? What must be happening to her during her menses? God alone knows. Which brings to you to that eternal question, which at some point in your life, you'll ask yourself, which at some point in my life, I asked myself. And which is that there are two ongoing conflicts of human existence. The survival of the fittest. The survival of the fittest within life, vis-a-vis life itself. Each one of us has an option. Like the bulk of the West, we could choose to support the former, survival of the fittest. Or like, because we are in India, because we have cultural values, because we are steeped in religiosity, whether we decided that life matters and life should and shall always matter. That is the important point on which all of you have to wonder. The question is not whether you go out of this auditorium and start doing work for the Wandering Mentally Ill Ghaziabad. No. The question is not whether you ever look back at a wandering mentally ill on the road ever in your whole life. The question is whether you ever did something for the have-nots that are there in India, whether it is leprosy, whether it is tuberculosis, whether it is cancer, whether it is young children, whether it is geriatric patients, whatever, whether there are people who are uneducated. Innumerable sections of population are neglected purely because they were born in that place at that time and they didn't have the facilities which you have or which I had. This is us in Vinadu. This is the most famous newspaper of Andhra Pradesh. This is the Guardian of UK. I mean, multiple newspapers have covered us up. I mean, I'm very happy with the media because they keep, but despite all that, the stigma against psychiatry is so deeply entrenched that, again, back to the same thing, mansik bimari kyun hota hai? This is in Nepal, by the way. This is in Jammu. Various supporters have come forward over the years. Now we are in existence for the last 35 years. I don't know how many of you know this guy, Nani Palkiwala. He was a very senior jurist person, very, very renowned Parsi gentleman. He gave us donation at that time. This is an elderly lady who donated funds for the construction of two units, one in the name of her father and one in the name of her mother. Brilliant support. GIC RA has helped us a lot. This is again Urdu in Jammu, West Bengal, Kanpur, Andhra Pradesh. And this is in Jharkhand. This lady who's there in the center, because of this lady, was picked up by us, treated. The people in the village thought that she was a witch and they beat her up very badly, hit her very badly. And in the process, she became mentally ill and ran away from the village. Six people were arrested in the matter. 4 years later, she was reunited to the family. Our social worker writes that the area is very dangerous, so I took the help of local police. They have arranged room for me to stay. This is Lakshmi Priya Bishoi. She's from Orissa, personally. Brilliant work. She goes into naxalite areas. She goes into deep remote areas with the help of the police, does the reunion. Now, she is not a qualified social worker. She has done her MA in something. But because of the emotions involved, gradually over a period of time, over the number of years that she has been with us, she has changed. That is the emotions and that is the passion which is responsible for taking you where you are. She doesn't shy away from anything. A female going into an accelerated area with the police and doing the reunion. This is Reader's Digest. This is in Jharkhand, Orissa, Assam. Now you see this. These are in Assam as a token of gratitude, they give this shawl, gamcha. So every time my staff goes to reunite, they are given this as a token of love and affection. This is a guy who is not a qualified social worker. He's a BCom guy. He did his post-graduation, something else, came, met us, liked the job, joined up. Brilliant support. Himachal Pradesh, Karnataka, Madhya Pradesh. And this is a magazine which I feel all of you must subscribe. It's an internet magazine, The Better India. It talks only about the good things which happen all over India. Brilliant effort. This is in Punjab, Telangana. And this year, on Mother's Day, we reunited this guy with his parents in Almora, in Uttarakhand. So people who have been thought of as dead are reunited. Various students come over. We try and encourage all the students, like how I've come over here. So same way, we try and talk to all the students, try and see to it that they take to social work. We have various government collaborations which are there. I'll just go through it fast. And this is with our work with various NGOs. A lot of NGOs exist all over India who pick up destitutes, but they don't know what to do with them. So these are 12 patients, all of them picked up from Apna Ghar in Delhi. And all the 12 were from UP, Bihar, and we had an ambulance trip which started off from Delhi and went and reunited everybody. This is the entire 25 patients at a single shot from the entire Tamil Nadu. Various districts of Tamil Nadu, we picked up the patients, brought them to our center. 25 patients at a time. This is a guy who was in Chennai Mental Hospital. He was from Arunachal Pradesh. That same social worker which I told you, who is brilliant. He went there, you require a permit to enter Arunachal Pradesh. That guy heard out the whole story. He said, forget the permit. You go and reunite him. Now, this guy was reunited in Arunachal Pradesh. This is Arunachal Pradesh. This fellow is the social worker. This fellow and this fellow. These are two of my staff. Brilliant. Now, this boy, that cop who was there, who gave them the permit, was so moved by the whole thing that he said that there exists a boy who was picked up by them, thinking that the man was a child lifter and he was put behind bars. He said, I've seen this person and I think he's mentally ill. Why didn't you take him? So this patient is being referred by this cop from Arunachal Pradesh, from Bordumsa in Arunachal Pradesh to our social worker. This is our social worker. This is our social worker. This is our social worker. And the same patient yesterday night, he's in the train with that social worker going to Jharkhand district. Paschimi Singhubam. 1 month is all that it took to reunite. 1 month is all that it took to change the entire life. So the question is not, the essence of the whole thing is that, did you have that proactiveness to reach out? Did you have the proactiveness and the decency and the compassion and the empathy to reach out to the person who was underprivileged? To think of somebody else other than your own self, other than your own father, mother, brothers, sisters, daughters, sons. Did you ever think of anybody else? If you think, there are people around to help you out. You see this. This fellow was picked up, brought by from Kerala. He was picked up there by an NGO called Snehal. This is the same person at that time. On this November, on Chhat Puja, which is a very important occasion for North Indians in Bihar, everything, his parents had just gone to the pond, done that Chhat Puja and come back when they found that the patient was in front of them. This is the photo of the guy hung up in the wall. An actual dead body was brought by the police. An actual death certificate has been issued. And the person is brought back to the family. Now it is different that this particular case was covered by midday newspaper. Perhaps because of the fact that there was a death certificate issued, etc., etc., there was legality involved, etc., etc. Had it not been recovered, that joy of getting to know that you have reunited a son with the parents, with the wife, with the children on Chhat Puja Day, nobody can take it away. So probe launched into issuance of living man's death certificate. What are living dead's legal rights? Multiple coverage. This is another this thing where a mother and a child are on the roads. This is the mother, this is the child. This is September 2019. Now, unfortunately, because COVID was on, the mother and the child were separated and the child was given to somebody else for foster care. It became a big thing. That person was a well-known Bollywood director. He wanted to keep the child. He involved politicians to see to it that the child was not parted, etc., etc. Again, huge newspaper coverage. This is Indira Jaisingh. Woman has every right to get custody of her own child. The hue and cry. Finally, the mother and the child were back. A series of articles came in the newspapers. Finally, woman beats mental illness to win baby back from foster age. Mother and child reunited in Ara in Bihar. And today, we are following up on the child, and the child is doing very well, and the mother is doing very well. That is joy. You see this is a mother. And this is a child, her child. These are two police constables, by the way. These are women, the police in Bombay and Maharashtra is very active in terms of helping out the wandering mentally ill. In particular, they are female wandering mentally ill. This is 6th February 2021. 1 month later, they are in their village in Madhya Pradesh because of the fact that this lady remembered the person to whom she had voted. And that person was very popular in Madhya Pradesh. And from that, they found out where exactly. Otherwise, she was a tribal, not able to speak very clearly. Again, you see this. Mother with a child, bad shape. Again, picked up by Dadar Railway Police Line. Great on their part of intercepted and reached out to us. So you have interactions with the police, you have interaction with the child welfare committee, you have interactions with the pediatrician, you have interaction with the social workers. Our social workers are mothering the child while the mother is becoming all right. Big thing. Lot of effort. But at the end of the day, it is worth it. This is her in Ranchi, Jharkhand. This is the patient, this is the child. This is our social worker holding the child. This is the mother, this is the child. Transformation. Such is life. The point is, you have to be proactive. You have to move forward to think of doing all this. So when I got the Raymond Magsaysay Award, there was an Indian Psychiatric Conference, national. Dr. Ajit Bhide, who was the president at that time, said that in his entire lifetime, in the entire 30 years of his existence, he had never heard of Shraddha. He had never heard of Dr. Bharat Vatwani. And he made it out as if we were altruistic. The truth, I mean, I thought about it later on, that it's not that we were altruistic. We had our own joys. We had our moments of happiness in the reunions that we did. We had our joy from that emotional this of the parent meeting the child. That was something. I remember a particular case in Bihar wherein the boy was reunited with the mother. Now, he was the only son of the parents. The mother had, because of the fact that he was the only boy, she had gone into depression, she had stopped eating. And 4 hours before my social worker reached the village, that mother expired. So you felt, all of them felt, all the villagers felt that, look, wish she had come 4 hours earlier, wish she had come yesterday, and the mother would have survived. Then they felt that in our Hindu culture, there is that saying that agar bete ne maa ki chita lagai, to maa ki atma swarg mein jati hai. And that boy did that. After doing that, the whole village was tearful. Everybody was crying. Everybody touched the feet of my social worker. My social worker rang me up from Bihar. And he said, sir, aisa aisa hua. And he was crying profusely on the phone. And I started crying this side. And at that moment, forget whether any Indian psychiatric society or anybody has ever appreciated your work. Forget the Ramon Magsaysay Award. Forget the fact that we are in IMT today. Forget everything. The truth is that at that moment, you believe that the sun, the moon, the stars, the planets, our NGO, that social worker, that mother and that son are aligned. That is destiny. That is what it is. We received an email from this boy saying that his father was lost because of mental illness. And this is the last photo that they have. This guy has disappeared. Until today, we have not been able to find him. So what is it that basically I'm trying to achieve over here? The truth is that we, all of us, somehow have got wired over years to think about ourselves. Lokmanya Tilak, very famous freedom fighter. The real spirit is to make the country a family instead of working only for your own. The step beyond is to serve humanity. The next step is to serve God. These are the facts that we need to take away. And these are the facts that will allow us to imbibe just that little bit of emotion, passion, which will be required to actually make the change. There's no point in reading on the airport this thing that be the change that you wish others to be. It's just the wordings which are written across. How deep are you into that sentence? How deep are you into that particular philosophy? That is what counts. I don't know how many of you have heard of Vinoba Bhave. During COVID times, I read his autobiography twice. I read his book called The Gita twice. Phenomenal. Just phenomenal. If you get an opportunity, don't miss it. Read it. It's available, easily available. He was in jail in 1930 when he thought that let's try and lift up the spirits of all the people who are jailed, all the freedom fighters. So he started every week having one adhyaya of the Gita on which he started doing a discourse. That discourse was written down by one Sane Guruji, famous Maharashtrian person. And that entire thing which Sane Guruji wrote down was published in the form of the Gita. And that Gita is one of the most unbelievable descriptions, one of the most unbelievable concepts, visualizations of the Gita. Gita has been deciphered by many people. And in which Vinoba Bhave has written that for me, that had a man of pure heart like Sanayi Guruji not do shorthand, these talks would have remained confined to the speaker. That means it would have remained in the jail had Sanayi Guruji not written it down. But the truth is that, and he says that for me, that was enough. Even if it would have remained within the jail, even if it had remained within those people. It was for my own sake that I was delivering the lecture. Same way, whatever we are doing with the Wandering Mentally Ill is for our own sake. If somebody's helped out, great. If we got the Ramon Magsaysay Award, great. It created a great amount of awareness for mental illness. But had it not been the case, we were doing it because there was joy in what we were doing. Again, another freedom fighter, which I don't know how many of you have heard of, is this lady called Aruna Asaf Ali. She, at the age of 21, was jailed for salt satyagraha in 1930. Salt satyagraha of Gandhi. She was jailed. How many of us would be ready to go to jail for a patriotic cause? How many of us would be ready to go to do anything beyond ourselves? How many of us? Ask ourselves the actual honest truth. At the age of 33, she became the face of the Quit India movement by planting the Indian flag at the Gwalior Tank Maidan. At the age of 33, for 4 years, she was in hiding. Imagine a woman between 33 and 37, the prime years of her life, she's in hiding. That is giving. Had I not mentioned it to you, I don't think so. Many of you would know or have ever heard about her. So at the end of the day, the question is not whether somebody got a Ramon Magsaysay Award or not somebody whether got a Padma Shri or whatnot. The Padma Shri was initiated in 1954. Ramon Magsaysay Award was initiated in 1957. Who remembers who got the award in 2010, 2000, 1990, 1980? Who remembers? Nobody remembers. What matters is the truth, is the goodness that you as individuals have spread in society. That is what matters. If you take away that much from this talk, then it's a talk which is worth its weight in gold. Otherwise, it's worth nothing. I mean, when I look at Baba Amte, I feel hundreds, thousands of people must have visited him as visitors. He must have tried to light the spark in many people. Perhaps he succeeded in me. Same way, I got an invitation from Kasturi Das for giving this talk. And she said, you can do it online. I chose offline because I felt that let me try in my own small way to emulate Baba Amte and see whether there's any spark which could be lit up in any one of you. Whether I, within this audience and within the people around who are listening to this talk, whether I could find another Dr. Bharat Vatwani who could take things to a different level. So it is a thought that Baba Amte had that passion. Why not try and do it? I have my own set of medical problems, but even then I came. Unless you reach out, unless you are proactive, things don't move. Now the question is, when will all of you become proactive? That is the question. You see this. Elderly gentleman. Anyway, I think I'll take up too much time. I'll proceed ahead. You listen to this video.
Naam kya aapka? Rambilas. Jila kaun sa hai?
Murshidabad.
Bengal.
Haan, Bengal.
Yahan kaise aa gaye?
Yahan aa gaye. Aaye se yahan. Dangi puri maar.
Haan.
Kaam karne ke liye.
Haan.
Haan, theek karke saath mein.
Pair ab theek hai? घर जाना चाहते हो
जी?
घर जाना चाहते हो?
घर छोटी हो जाए बड़ी कुछ बात होगी
क्या करोगे घर जाके?
हाँ
घर जाके क्या करोगे?
मिल के रहेंगे सबका साल आज कहीं मर गया 3 साल हो गए
3 साल हो गए घर वालों लग रहा होगा मर गए आप
घर वाले कुछ पता नहीं मैं यहाँ पर हूँ
मन कैसा रहता है आपका
हाँ?
मन कैसा रहता है आपका
आप बोलो तो सोचता तो मर गया होगा
मन कैसा रहता है आपका
हर जिला मन बढ़िया लगे हर है हर है
बेचैनी रहती है क्या आपको
हाँ?
बेचैनी सी लगती है
बेचैनी तो लगे जी जो अपना घर है बाल बच्चा सब है
कितने बच्चे हैं आपके
मेरे 2 बच्चे 8 नाती पोता है
काम क्या करते थे घर जाके
काम
क्या करते थे पहले आप लड़के टिकट बेचते थे लॉटरी वाला
हेलो
द सेम पर्सन लाइंग इन एन एनजीओ फॉर 3 इयर्स रियूनाइटेड विद हिज फैमिली इन वेस्ट बंगाल मुर्शिदाबाद वेस्ट बंगाल हैड अवर सोशल वर्कर नॉट प्रोएक्टिवली इंटरेक्टेड विद हिम नॉट सेंड दिस वीडियो ओवर टू मी परहैप्स ही वुड हैव डाइड इन दैट पर्टिकुलर सेंटर Now the question is, who will do that proactiveness? That is the question. What is the truth? The truth is that our country bleeds for its countrymen. A lot of us may have come from very poor backgrounds and have reached IMT, have reached medical colleges, have become postgraduates, have done this, have done that. Give us an opportunity to go abroad, we rush abroad. The number of psychiatrists, of Indian psychiatrists in the UK, the number of Indian psychiatrists in the USA are more than the number of Indian psychiatrists in India. That is the truth. Prime Minister Manmohan Singh started off this Indian Institute of Science, Education and Research, ISER, for pure sciences. My daughter was one of the students. Majority of the classmates of hers have gone abroad, majority. So where is that sense of patriotism? Intelligence is being drained in bulk. At the end of the day, all of us forget the the grassroots from where we have come, the struggles that we did, and do not acknowledge that person who's on the other side of the road or in a remote village. We do not acknowledge. That is a tragedy. There is that famous Jagjit Singh song of a Mirza Ghalib ghazal. Na tha kuch to khuda tha, kuch na hota to khuda hota. Duboya humko hone mein, na hota main to kya hota. If we were not existing, what difference would I made? What difference would I made if we were not written about, if we were not spoken about, if we never got the Raymond Magsaysay Award? Nothing. All that matters was whether you took forward that seed of goodness which was planted within you by the gods above and distributed to somebody else. That is all that matters. So to end this talk, from the beginning of time, the world has always been a conflict between truth and evil, between justice and injustice, between the right and the wrong. Any genuine MBA person, any genuine IMT MBA person, irrespective of his particular sphere of activities, supports and should be a torchbearer of the former. Should be. Where the stone thrown into the pond of life falls, it matters not. Far beyond are the ripples that the stone hitting that pond has caused. It is not individual domains of expertise that you represent. It is not finance, it is not marketing, it is not sales, it is not this, it is not that. It is the hope of a collective good within society that all of you represent. It is a hope that truth and God shall prevail within all of us, within mankind at large, and ultimately all of you, you, me, us, will join in eternal bonding to the greater cosmos of a God's creation beyond. That is the aim. The good socially conscious IMT MBA graduate with this particular cause of the underprivileged, I repeat, with this particular cause of the underprivileged, which may not at all be the wandering mentally ill, is mightier than the warrior with his sword. While some of us are not given due recognition by society, I believe our contribution can change the world. We can light the spark in the smallest of ways until the goodness cumulatively adds up to a tidal wave of truth. If at the end of your journey, as an IMT MBA graduate, if at the end of your journey, the level of compassion, the level of sympathy, the level of decency, care, concern, hope, if that level of decency, care, concern, hope, compassion, empathy, if that level of wanting justice, wanting equality, wanting non-discrimination towards the underprivileged in society was to increase even marginally, because of this talk of mine, then I would believe from the bottom of my heart that is a talk which has served its purpose. Ultimately, so that ultimately, eternally and into infinity, your tears, my tears, our tears, and the tears of the common man join to form one. That is the ultimate goal. That has to be our dream, our nirvana, our hope, our prayer, our anthem, our everything. That can we do something combined? Can IMT MBA graduates do something for the underprivileged within society? Can we do? Can we rise to that level? That is the issue. If we can do that, then our India will be a different India altogether. Thank you.
If you have some time for a few questions. Yeah. We are now open to questions. People with questions can raise their hands and we'll have a mic sent to you.
A very good afternoon, sir. It was a very touching speech, and we saw many facets which you are not, which you did not actually realize. So my question is that during COVID, there was a mass migration of people from cities towards their hometowns, and there's a lot of suffering. So could you, from your, could you tell your point of view actually, what happened? What did you see during that time?
See, honestly, it was there was a huge amount of suffering because the lockdown had been announced very suddenly without taking into consideration all the impact of the lockdown. In cities, people live in very small shanty places. There's very less ventilation, very less everything. And the fear that you might die because of the COVID would naturally want you to reach out to home, to reach out to village, to reach out to where you were born. I mean, that is a natural psychological maneuver of anybody. Today, if you have cancer in the US and you know you're going to die, you wish you could take the next flight home and go to your gaon in the village and die there. So the people chose that. Unfortunately, the travel and there are no actual facilities available. So everybody decided to walk and everybody walked. And females, one female took her father for 1500 kilometers, etc. It was a very tragic thing. I believe it could have been avoided had there been better planning, but then it's a very political issue. So we don't need to go into that. But having said that, we, at least in Shraddha, what we did was we distributed grains to 5,000 tribal families in Karjat, wherein we officially got the record from the tehsildar of the families who were below the poverty line, who were widowed, who were handicapped, etc. And we went ahead. I don't have the slides. If you see the slides, people, I mean, a mother and the child walked down from a hill 11 kilometers just to receive that bag of 21 kilometers of grains, etc. All this makes you realize that, look, boss, there's another world out there. And it made me, I mean, I was going through a very bad depression myself during the COVID time. So there's a friend of mine in the US, and every time he would ask that, do you need any funds? And I would tell him no. I wrote to him, boss, I'm in very bad shape. Please, yeah, send me funds. He actually sent $30,000. And we, with that $30,000, we went to each and every village. Every day we were going out and distributing grains. Every day. And that thought of people coming from so far, barefoot, lifting a bag of 21 kilos of grains and again going back, it's heartrending. That is a essential concept which I'm trying to convey, that there exists a different world beyond all of us. There exists a different world beyond this auditorium. There exists something way beyond. 80% of Karjat Taluka is a tribal area. Miserable, apathetic condition. And that is the same everywhere. Ours is not the only NGO. Multiple NGOs did multiple work. So many people died on the way. So many people lost their lives. So many people lost their loved ones. Things are catastrophic. If you are moved to tears by those vision, and at some point of time, knowing that you still can't do anything, but somehow that vision remains and that tears remain and that images remain, that thing at some point of time, at some day will evoke you, will inspire you, will instill you to do, go beyond the distance. That will take you. I was in a hurry. Otherwise, this guy who we reunited in Murshidabad, we reunited because prior to him, there was another elderly fellow. He said he wanted to go home. Now, it was November, December, peak time. He was in Delhi, that elderly fellow whose video I didn't show. The village was in Muzaffarpur in Bihar. Honestly, I didn't have the guts to take him in the ambulance from that Delhi to Bihar because I felt he might die on the way. So I sent my social worker to try and trace out the relatives. The social worker could not trace out. Sometimes it's very difficult to trace out the elderly people's. That guy died in that NGO. And I was so heartbroken, I couldn't sleep for 2 days. I felt I'd just done injustice to him. And that made me go for the next guy who was from Murshidabad. I said, come hell or high water, this guy I'll reunite. So taking a guy from an NGO, elderly person with all the inherent risks, taking him by train and making him reach in between the train, he developed asthma, whatever. But that thing is there, yeah, that there's an elderly guy, he's dying. in the NGO. What is the point of that NGO trying to say, look, we are sheltering 100 people or 1,000 people or 2,000 people? Doesn't make sense. Is the guy happy in that NGO? He wants to go home, boss. Like he said, aat natu hai mere. Main kya karunga ghar pe jaake wo bhul jao. Aat natu hai mere. Do bachche hain. That emotion takes you. So if you remember all those evocative emotions of the COVID times and keep them, at some point of time, they will inspire you to reach out to somebody else. I'm definite of that.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, I also have a question. So when we are unifying the people with their families, do you face any stigma in the village communities themselves about mental illness? Because specifically in the hinterlands, there's still a stigma. There's a, not even in the cities, there's a stigma, but it's much more prominent in village communities. How do you deal with that?
See, you deal with that by the fact that the social workers are trained. They've got experience in talking to the village elders. They've got experience in talking to the sarpanch. They've got experience in talking to the police. It's a slow ball, slow move. I had heard an interview of Anand Grover, this Supreme Court lawyer. And he said that any social cause is a slow burn. He was on that case of LGBT for 14 years at a stretch before LGBT got its this thing. So since time immemorial, we are fighting for our rights. It is only now that things apparently are moving a little bit. When we talk of this book, which the Buddha and his Dhamma, which Baba Sahib Ambedkar wrote, you know, way back. So the actual evolution of that whole development concept may take a long, long, long time. There is a slide which I didn't show, but I don't know how many of you have heard of Savitribai Phule. She was a person who belonged to OBC community. She was a Mali community. She was married to a guy called Jyotiba Phule. Jyotiba Phule taught her, educated her, and finally inspired her to set out her own school for women. She is the first female headmistress of the entire India. When she started off and she started that school, people used to throw gobar on her. However, she continued. Jyotiba told her that, look, take another additional sari and wear an additional sari and continue the school. Finally, Jyotiba's parents threw Jyotiba and Savitribai Phule out of their house, saying that women should not be educated, etc., etc., etc. They left their house. They went to a guy called Usman Sheikh. They lived in that fellow's house. And there was one female called Fatima Sheikh. Finally, Fatima Sheikh and Savitribai Phule started 17 schools exclusively for females in Maharashtra between 1848 to 1852. Not even 19th century. Not even 20th century. 19th century. 165 years later, in 2015, Pune University was renamed as the Savitribai Phule University. Now, did Savitribai Phule know that the Pune University would be renamed after that? No. She did it because she felt that women should be educated. And today, there are so many females in this audience. They don't know who started this movement. I guarantee you, none of them must have heard of Savitribai Phule. So the truth is, Savitribai Phule herself does not realize that this is the impact 150 years down the line. Today, all that we have done is reunited 9,000, 10,000 patients, boss. What about all those people on the roads? Someday, I hope, someday the whole Shraddha team hopes that a day will come, maybe 10 years down the line, 20 years down the line, 50 years down the line, 100 years down the line, that there will not be a single wandering mentally ill on the roads of India. That is the concept. And you realize that that is the concept because you read all these people and who have done this for such a long, 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 long period of time. And you realize that social change is a slow change. You have to be like that tree which is stuck in the ground. Yeah? You don't move. You don't budge. You hold on. If you can do that, then that will cause change. Did Vinoba Bhave know that I would be speaking about him in 2022 on this stage? He didn't know. Did Gandhi know that we would be having a thing called I Am the Change specifically in IMT Ghaziabad? He didn't know. He couldn't care less. Vinoba Bhave couldn't care less whether it was spoken or not spoken. Savitribai Phule could not care less. I couldn't give a damn whether I was called or not called. We do what we do because of the passion and the emotions which are involved in the work. That is what takes you forward. That is the essence of the whole thing, which I, over a period of innumerable readings of all social workers, all freedom fighters, everybody, have realized that they are so absorbed and so focused on the work, and the joy which it gives them is something different. The joy with those first 10, 20, 30 children, females must have given to Savitribai Phule, must have been unimaginable. That is change, and that causes change. The joy which Anand Grover got when he won that LGBT case, oh boy, unbelievable. The whole front newspaper headlines was there, first page. He did something to that community. 10 years down the line, 20 years down the line, the entire LGBT community will have forgotten who is Anand Grover. But the goodness remains. That is the point.
Any questions?
Good afternoon, sir. We can say that the levels of awareness and sensitivity are on the rise concerning mental health problems, especially with the younger generation. But that also means that oftentimes older generations can be insensitive regarding these issues. So is there, how do you as an organization tackle this problem, or make use of the fact that newer generations are more open to this?
See, the entire workforce of Shraddha involves the younger generation. So when you reach a village, you start talking to the elders, you start talking to the sarpanch, you start talking to the police, you try and trace out who is the most sensitive amongst them, who understands what psychiatry is all about. There are so many cases wherein the patient may have had a fight with the neighbor, so the neighbor doesn't want the patient. In this case where I talked about the JJ School of Arts lecturer, while reinstating him back in the job, the dean was very against reinstating him. Why? Because this fellow had written some vulgar, abusive language on the walls against the dean. So I personally apologized to the dean. I said, look, boss, whatever he has done is not, he was not in his senses. Today he's sitting in front of you. He's apologizing. I am apologizing. Let's take this forward. Let's not think that what he did was in his senses. It took time. It took me 2 hours of conviction. I said, if you want, I'll touch your feet. But try and understand that this is mental illness. Why would the same person who is a gold medalist from your institute write something abusive against you on the walls unless he's mentally ill? It takes time to sink a concept. It takes time to break walls. It takes time to break barriers. So these are slow processes. The most important thing which I feel which is missing in the younger generation, which I see today, is it's not that they are not empathetic, but their thing is very short fused. They want that within one day, if it doesn't happen, they give up. It doesn't work like that. You have to go on persisting. To get that guy reinstated in the government job, it took me 6 months. I was going to the mantralaya and coming back, going to the mantralaya and coming back. Chappal gis gayi yaar. But finally, we got that guy the job back. It's a slow process. So unless, and I, for one, I mean, personal sharing, I get inspired by reading about people who have actually done the work. So I got inspired by Baba Amte. So I get inspired by Savitribai Phule. I got inspired by Vinoba Bhave. I mean, I was stunned here when I read his book. I couldn't believe that such a book could be written. I was stunned when Baba Sahib Ambedkar, I read the book. These are real people. We are not talking about reading the Bible. We are not talking about reading the Quran. We are not talking about reading the Gita. We are talking about real people who have actually done work. And I get terrifically inspired by them. I get terrifically inspired. There's one female called Nirmala Deshpande. I went through the slide. She was a follower of Gandhi. At the age of 23, she walked 30,000 kilometers with Vinoba Bhave in the Padyatras. She was known as the Manas Kanya of Bhave. She finally, in an attempt to reunite and remove communal disharmony, she got a Puraskar from Pakistan, Sitare Imtiaz, in 2005. She was nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize. You have never heard of her. Honestly, I had never heard about her. Until you start probing and until you start wondering how did people get into this groove. And you realize that that person originally on day one was as ordinary a student as the student sitting in this auditorium. But something moved, something clicked, something shook them. And that person started. So I mean, you have not heard of Nirmala Deshpande. I have never heard of Nirmala. I read about her. When you read about people and you realize they are real life people at the age of 23, to do that 30,000 kilometers padyatra is not a joke, yeah. And the person has done it. And then to be award, then to be nominated by for the Nobel Peace Prize is something phenomenal. Now again, the question is, did she do it thinking that she'll be nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize? No. Did she do it because she thought she'll get an award from Pakistan? No. She did it because her heart, her soul, her passion, her emotions, her entire being was in that. Atma se judi hai yaar, cause ke saath. That is what counts. The day you reach that level of functioning, then you are some, then it's something else. So one has to keep getting continuously inspired and continuously motivated by all this story that you read to reach that level. It's a slow process. I've been suicidal myself. I've been taken medications myself. So it's a very slow process. It's not that easy. It's very easy to just, like I said, it's very easy to write on the airport, be the change that you wish to see within others. Simplest of sentences. It's a pani kam chai sentence. Yeah? It has got zero impact, zero meaning, zero validity. The truth is much more difficult. So when you go on and on and on and on, which is what Gandhi did, which is what Nirmala Deshpande did, which is what Vinoba Bhave did, which is what Savitri Bai Phule did. There are hundreds, thousands of people who died in the freedom struggle whose names are not mentioned anywhere. Do they not count? They count. They count, and in their own minds they count. The guy who designed the national flag, our Indian national flag, was a guy called Pingali Venkaiah from Andhra Pradesh. He died in poverty. He died in absolute poverty. He was a follower of Gandhi. Now, I read about him, so I know who is he. Supposing you would not have read about it. Now, the question is, which I feel, that supposing you meet Pingali Venkaiah today and ask him, sir, dekho, aisa hai, aap finally garibi mein guzar jaoge, aapka koi puchega bhi nahi, koi manega bhi nahi, koi kuch nahi karega. Do you want to live this life again? And he'll say yes. Because he's not jured out to the cause because of name, fame, nothing. He's jured out to the cause because he wants to do that particular thing. Uske atma se juda hua hai. That is the point. That is a takeaway. There's one in Calcutta, there's an area which is known as BBD Bagh. It is named after three people. Binoy, something, Dinesh Gupta, and one more. Yeah. So these are three people who actually killed the English superintendent of jail over there because he was a rotten person. The moment they killed him, they knew they would get arrested. They got arrested, they got hanged. Did they know that a Bagh will be named after them in Calcutta? Did they know that Dr. Vatwani will be standing on this dais on this month and talking about them? They didn't. But the passion is there. You want to do something for the country, you do it. And you die with that thing that I did, what had to be done. That's the takeaway. Unfortunately, that somehow that takeaway, because of social media, because of a lot of distractions, has got diluted very badly nowadays in current generation. And people are all the time saying, "Arey, yaar, I took. And nobody appreciated and this and that." Array, it's not a question of appreciation, boss. To hell with the appreciation. That guy's across, that prisoner, that jailer, that superintendent is a rotten human being. You want to kill him, go ahead and do it. Don't ask the government what they will do for you. Don't ask the government whether there'll be a BBD Bagh named after you. Did I do what I do? Did the whole team of Shraddha do what it did in order to get this Ramon Magsaysay award? No. We did because we believe in the cause. We believe that it's unfair. It's unjust. Why should a man who's just by pure bad luck afflicted with a mental illness wander out from the house and be on the roads for the rest of his life? For what? Why should that mother and child be on the roads for the rest of their life? What will happen to them? That is that you know, like I was talking to this, that atma jhunjhunate rehti hai. That jhunjhuna takes you forward.
There's a question there.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, as you said that any social change is a slow burn. So after fighting this battle for so many years, do you see any acceptance in part of the society or authorities as a whole in taking up such initiatives on their own?
I don't see, I mean, I do see change to some ways, in some ways. I remember Sharda Menon, she was the first female psychiatrist in the whole of India. She's a Padma Shri. She had called us over 10 years back, 12 years back, to Chennai Mental Hospital and said, why don't you help out in reuniting? Now, she was a retired person. I was not treated with great respect. She was not treated with great respect. But somehow we started the ball moving. Now, today, as on date, we have a MOU signed with Chennai Mental Hospital. We are getting repeated calls from the entire Tamil Nadu for reuniting all the wandering mentally ill in the pickup. Tamil Nadu is the most proactive state in the whole of India for the wandering mentally ill. So it's a slow burn. We got a MOU signed with the Andhra Pradesh state government. We got last week, 2 weeks ago, we got a MOU signed with the Maharashtra state government. This talk has been going on for years that let's sign, let's do something. Everybody says, you're doing extraordinary work. We have heard about you. Ye hai, wo hai. But then things dwindle. So it's you take it for granted, it's a slow burn. But you continue. And gradually over a period of time, people are, believe it or not, at 2:30 in the night, we have had female police constable along with their jeep bring a female patient to Shraddha Karjan. They know that this in this institution, the female is safe. And in this institution, the female will get cured. And she will get reunited. This child and mother-child thing, big thing it is, because Child Welfare Committee is a huge organization by itself in a separate domain. The police is a huge organization by themselves in a separate domain. The female is picked up, she's picked up by a Mahila Ashram in a separate government domain. And you have to reunite after fulfilling all their legal obligations. But they come forward. So we have done 14 cases of mother and child, which 10 years back, I would have never thought of touching. But we did it. And in all this, yes, people are helping out. I mean, finally, the Dadar police approached us. Not that we went and asked them. They approached us and they said, we have got a mother and child. Can you help out? Then I went to meet the pediatrician. He helped out with the child. And then naturally, our nurses, our female social worker, they do the mothering of the kid while the mother is becoming all right. One hell of a thing. But I mean, when we started the Karjat project, somebody had asked me that, what is your dream? I said, see, yeah, the calendar year mein 365 days. Ek din chodke ek din, agar ek reunion ho gaya, to apna nirvana. That means I was targeting 182 reunions in a year. 2019, just before COVID, we did 1,114 reunions. Three reunions a day, boss. Moving like a bloody rocket, yeah. The social worker knew, tak, 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 tak. वो बात करने से पता चल जाता है ये पेशेंट इधर का है इसका जवान इधर का है इन महाराष्ट्र ये जो हो बोलता है दैट इज फ्रॉम नागपुर दैट इज फ्रॉम अकोला दैट इज अ कोल्हापुर थिंग दैट इज दिस दे मोमेंट द पर्सन से माय नेम इज दिस यादव दे ट्रेस आउट द एंटायर यादव इन उत्तर प्रदेश एंड ट्रेस आउट दैट सरपंच एंड ट्रेस आउट द विलेज बिकम सो फैंटास्टिक एट द टीम विद इन वन मंथ फ्रॉम अरुणाचल प्रदेश टुडे दिस गाइज टुडे ही मस्ट हैव बीन रीयूनाइटेड बाय नाउ इन झारखंड दैट इज दैट That is the level of commitment which they've got. I mean, the team is just out of this world. So you can get change in various sectors. I mean, 15 years back, if somebody would have told me that, boss, a cop in Arunachal Pradesh will hand over a patient to you, I would have never believed it. But he did. He did. He did it with the official letter. Not only that, he begged my social worker that, boss, you take him. Mine is a government job. Ek saal ke baad transfer ho jayega. Main yahan se nikal jayega. Ye banda zindagi bhar Arunachal Pradesh mein mar jayega. Take him. We did it. And now that social worker of mine is in touch with that cop. So huge. I mean, in Orissa, we did a reunion. This female, there's another male guy. We did a reunion. 1.8 million views on just that newspaper, this thing. The newspaper had put it on their YouTube, this thing. 1.8 million people became aware of mental illness in their local Oriya language. I would have never dreamt of this 15 years ago. So the newspapers, so much coverage is there. The newspapers, that small video clips which are there, they are going on. People become aware. It's a very slow process. I think that what happens is, another thing which I want to stress is that people feel, no, it's not my job. There's an elected member of parliament for it. There's an elected corporator for it. There's an elected MLA for it. The government should do something. Why the government has put only 0.8% of its health budget on mental health, knowing that mental health is big. Let's not point faults of others here. What is it that you can do? What is it that the graduate of IMT Ghaziabad can do? That is the issue. Forget everybody else here. God bless them. Who gives a damn whether what are the MP doing? What are they called? And then you say, "Arey, nahi yaar, wo apna kaam nahi kar raha hai, police wale ka kaam hai." In today's day, there is a ruling that any wandering mentally ill should be picked up by the police and taken to the nearest public health facility. Do they do it? They don't. But instead of breaking your head against a system which may or may not change, why not do something for that guy? And then you prove to the people that, yes, this is the result. Then gradually, slowly but surely, the police changes. In the entire Western Railway, I don't know how many of you are familiar with Bombay. There's a Western Railway corridor and there's a Central Railway corridor. The local railway police are absolutely well-tuned. After 11:30, 12 o'clock in the night, we will get a call if there's a wandering mentally ill female on the road. I've had a cop who has brought a female with all her ornaments, saying that, "Nahi, sahab," I told him, if you want to keep it with you, we'll write at this. He said, "Nahi, sahab, aap rakho na. Jab reunite karega, tabhi bhej dena usko." That is the level of this. So it's a very slow process. I mean, 35 years, I've been through points and innumerable instances wherein I thought I would break down and collapse and whatever. And there are innumerable days when you feel like shutting down. But you continue.
So the session today was in equal parts poignant as well as awe-inspiring. I mean, your struggles, your story of overcoming those challenges, your tryst with inspiring people like Prakash Amte and Baba Amte, they were enlightening and inspiring. And on that note, I would request Professor Das to please deliver the vote of thanks.
Sir, I really don't know what to say because it's too heavy. Going through your journey, your stories. I don't think I'm going to deliver a formal vote of thanks here. On behalf of IMT and all our faculty members and all our officers, staff, and particularly all of our students, I'd just like to express our sincere gratitude. We are really humbled, honored, and really, really, I don't know what to say, that you have come all the way. And I remember that we first invited you in 2018, and back then you could not come over here. This time, in a very short notice, I just thought, let me just give it a try and reach out to you in case, if you can come over. And I was really not sure that whether you'll be able to, travel, because last time you had mentioned, that's why I had mentioned that you can even deliver it online, because I really thought that our students should get an opportunity to hear from you. But we are so grateful that despite your health condition, you have come all the way, and you are traveling since midnight, and you have come here. You have delivered such a passionate and such an inspiring session. I don't know. I mean, you said so many things which resonates. I mean, what we are trying to do here, it has got nothing to do with what you have done. Nowhere comparable. But one thing that resonates with me is that when we started 6 years back, we don't know, we had a philosophy behind it, that we wanted MBA students to know the other side of the world, because like us, many of them come from privileged background and they are not familiar with the other side of the country that we have. And we thought that MBA students do have the wherewithal to contribute to society through problem solving, whatever they have learned, and they learned so many things. They are skilled in so many different ways. And that was the vision with which we started. And our expectation, I will be honest in front of all of my students in the current batch. We started with a batch of 450 or so. And our expectation was, even if out of them four or five get impacted somewhere And going forward, they do something, whatever little way they can, we'll be happy. So our expectation has been that low. And we have completed, we didn't know whether we'll be able to continue with this. When we started, there was a lot of resentment among the students that we are MBA students, why would we do a 3-credit course, which is on, which will require us to work on ground. So with that, but I would also like to share with you very humbly that when that first batch came to the end of their journey of their sustainability and social responsibility course, we had a reflection, as part of evaluation that we always do. Even this year, we will do that. Many of them, many of them came up with these views that this was, eye-opening and life-changing experiences. I'm not saying that over the last 5 years, we have been able to bring any change to society, but our vision is little longer run because we are creating future business leaders and we don't want to only think of them as contributing to business. We want to see them as contributing to society also, because that is the philosophy of our founder. And that is the philosophy which is imbibed in IMT Ghaziabad. So we don't know, as you said, nobody knows what would be the impact, but we still try to do. And I can't think of any better way to start this 6th edition of the Sustainability and Social Responsibility course than the way you have done, sir. So it is really, really.
Thank you. Thank you. I hope that the talk has been fulfilling from my end. And I hope that we see in the true sense of the word, I am the change. Thank you. Okay.